All right. Good morning, Elkville Christian Church. Thank you guys for joining us this morning. Obviously, this is a little bit different for a lot of you guys, but thank you for being patient with us as we are transitioning and treading through some water that is completely different for us as well. Surprise, surprise, there are actually still a couple of things that are going to take place this week, even with the different things that are going on in our state in particular, and Richard will talk about more of that later. We are still hosting a blood drive this Thursday, starting at 1 o'clock in our, not Family Life Center, in our multi-purpose room. We just got that call today, and so if you still feel comfortable and are willing to come and donate blood, they are still going to be here from 1 to 6 o'clock this coming Thursday. Another thing that we're trying differently tonight is going to be a digital version of our taco for our junior and senior high group. Now, the fact that it's going to be online means I can't stop different people from coming. Maybe some adults want to chime in or even their elementary students. But we're going to be streaming live through our ECC Facebook account a little bit before 6 o'clock starts, but the content will start at 6 o'clock. And we're going to do a few different things that we normally do on Sunday nights, but we're just going to do it in a digital scale. And so I'm interested with it. I think it's going to be fun. I showed some bloopers as I attempted to do it early on with Hannah, and so I think it's going to be a great time. And so get on ECC's Facebook page at 6 o'clock tonight, and we're going to try a digital version of Taco. One of the things that I'm going to give you guys at the end of this broadcast is some resources for families that are stuck at home. One of those things that I'm really interested in is called Creating Fun with Your Kids. A lot of churches around the country and around the world even have been sharing their resources with different churches so that we could stay connected and make sure we get a lot of stuff to our individual churches. To keep them engaged and not be getting so bored, I guess, and stir crazy in their houses. And so one of the things is going to be a document called Creating Fun with Kids, which has about 16 or 17 different things and fun activities you can do inside your houses. One of the things that, as we were watching the broadcast of it, was turning your home into a cruise ship. You don't want to physically get on a cruise ship right now, but you can turn your house into a cruise ship. And so we're going to post that, and so look at that. And see if there's any ideas you might want to incorporate into your guys' houses. Another thing that I told you guys a long time ago on social media is to download the Parent Q app. This is one thing, especially right now, as you guys are at home and spending more time with your kids, that gives you different resources and videos and teaching things for you guys to give your kids church at home even. And so go on your app store and download the Parent Q app, put all of your kids in there, and I think it's a great resource that I'm already enjoying using it, and so is Hannah, and I think you guys will enjoy it as well. I think that's all. Before we transition into worship this morning and to sing it, I want to read you guys a passage out of Ephesians chapter 4, starting in verse 1, and it says this: Therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling of which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Let me pray for us this morning. Father God, we just love you so much, and we just thank you for always being with us. Even though times are different and even times are being scary right now, God, we know that you ultimately are in control, that you can comfort us even still through other people, even though we are being socially distant from one another. But God, let us just be patient with authorities, let us be patient with government, and let us be patient with our kids, probably. God, we know you love us so much. We know you're always with us, and you know, we can't stop praising you. We just know how much you love us, and you're going to love us through even the hard times that we're going through right now. So God, as we worship you this morning, as we worship you every day, we hope you're proud of us. We hope you accept our worship because we want it to be pleasing to you. We love you so much, God. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Aside, I'm leaving my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good. It's good.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it.
And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm trusting in what you say.
Today is the day. Oh, 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 oh,
today
oh,
is the day. I'm leaving my doubts behind. I'm giving my hopes and dreams to you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good. It's good.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Oh, oh, oh,
today is the day. I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
And all my days I'll live for you.
And I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
All my days I'll live.
Today is the day
you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrows. Where you lead me, I will follow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Oh, 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 oh.
Today is the day.
Oh, 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 oh.
Today is the day.
Oh, 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 oh.
Today is the day.
Is our God, and all will see how
great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, the Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
The very first time I visited Elkville Christian Church, you guys had a free book giveaway table that I took well advantage of. And one of the books I came across was called 50 Reasons Why Jesus Came to Die by Pastor John Piper. And one of the reasons that he gave in the book was this. He said, one of the reasons why Jesus came to die was to bring us to faith and keep us faithful. I want to pull a passage out of his book real quick. It says this: the new covenant is radically more effective than the old. It is enacted on the foundation of Jesus' suffering and death. To guarantee that this covenant will not fail, Christ takes the initiative to create the faith and secure the faithfulness of his people. He brings a new covenant people into being by writing the law, not just on stone, but on the heart. This is the spiritual life that enables us to see and believe in the glory of Jesus. This miracle creates the new covenant people. It is sure and certain because Christ bought it with his blood. When Christ died, he secured for his people not only new hearts, but new security. He will keep them, and they will persevere. The blood of the covenant guarantees it. You see, our faith is, or at least should be, grounded on one thing and one thing only, and that is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Our faith on that is totally essential. This is what means the most, that Christ died on our behalf so that we could live lives of love similar to him. to love our neighbor just as we love ourselves, just as Christ first loved us. To show our neighbors that Jesus came for all people, came not just for the religious, not just for the people that seemed good enough, but for every single type of person from every single walk of life. And so lean on Jesus to keep you faithful in all times. Tough times and other things will change, but Jesus is continually and consistently there to be with us and to lean on. Let me pray for us this morning. Father, again, we just say we love you so much, and we're so thankful for Jesus, who is the reason we have something to worship. You know, because you came and died for us and were resurrected on the third day, we have this hope and this promise that we will see you in heaven one day. We are so thankful for the work that you have done on our behalf, and now it's our turn to do the work here on earth as in heaven. God, as we take this communion, let us have you on our hearts to always remember what you did for us, for all of us, so that we could have eternal life with you one day. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And so if you have communion supplies right now, I'd ask you grab those. And I want to read, as we take it together, a passage out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I have received from the Lord that which was also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night on which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. One of the ways we also find in Scripture that we can worship God is through our offering. And that's one thing that's kind of hard when we're not here to do it in person. And so one of the avenues that we always have available for you guys is to give online. And you can do that by going to our website, elkvillechristian.com, and there is a link for online giving, which makes it very simple for you guys just to put in your credit card information and give that way. Another thing, if you're not so sure about doing that, is that we do have envelopes available here at the church that you can come and we can give to you that already have postmarked Elkville Christian Church's address on it with already a stamp on it included. So if that is something you'd rather do, that is totally fine. Just let us know. Give Richard or myself a call. Call the church office. Kayla has a phone from where she's working from, and we can make arrangements to get those to you. But I'm done right now, so I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Richard.
Good morning. I hope everybody's doing okay. This is pretty unprecedented in a lot of ways, and one of which is that we have to follow these ideas of what social distancing is. And because of that, it kind of leaves us into this situation where I'm standing in a room that is virtually empty, just a few people with us. And as we're recording this, and I have to look at a camera and keep my focus there so that you can see it. But the idea of this virus seems to be that it takes a little while to get it. It takes a couple of days, and you may not see symptoms for a while. And it multiplies so exponentially that this kind of thing takes place. It's not unprecedented in our country's history. They had this sort of thing a long time ago, over 100 years ago, a pandemic sort of hit, and they didn't have technology. They weren't able to do what we're doing this morning. And so that's a very good thing that we have this avenue, and I'm grateful for it. We can use the technology to continue to be a church. And a guy said to me the other day as we were talking about all of this, that one of the things that we have to do is remember that we are more than the four walls of the room that I'm in. We are a church of people who believe strongly in not just how we live as Christians, but how we live with each other. And we feel like this is a very compassionate way to do things. You're together as a family. You're watching this. You're participating in it. No, you're not in this room, but you're in our hearts. And hopefully we are also in your heart as well as we go through this time. And I encourage you to pay attention to what people are saying to you that's proper. Respect those authorities and listen to those people. But don't let fear come into play in here. Don't let fear guide you into some sort of false hope. Remember that God is still here. We are still living faithfully the mission of this church. And, you know, I believe wholeheartedly that this thing will pass. This virus will pass. And as it passes and we're back together again, and we come together, that first Sunday that we're all together is going to be a joyous occasion where we can love each other and serve each other and hug each other and shake hands and do all of those things that we've been missing. And I'm looking forward to that as well. I started a series of sermons from Romans, and I was going to continue those, but believe it or not, we're going to shorten some of these and keep these video streams a little bit shorter. And so I'm going to move off of Romans and move into a couple of sermons from different places from the schedule, from the lectionary. This week is from John chapter 9. It should be on this screen right here, and you can follow along. And also, as I'm doing these, we're going to continue on. The next one is Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. And then I'll continue on and on and on and keep finding sermons from that schedule that I hope are beneficial to everybody. It is a little weird in here. I have to tell everybody, just so you're watching, it's just a little odd. I've got just a few faces looking at me, and it's a little awkward, but I'll get through it, and I'm picturing your faces all through the room of where everybody sits, and it's keeping me from doing this a little differently. So I'm going to read from John chapter 9, just a few verses, and then we'll talk from there. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been born blind from birth. Rabbi, his disciples asked him, "Why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins?" "It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins," Jesus answered. "This happened so the power of God could be seen in him. We must quickly carry out the task assigned to us by the one who sent us. The night is coming, and then no one can work. But while I am here in the world, I am the light of the world." Then Jesus spit on the ground, made mud with saliva, and spread the mud over the blind man's eyes. He told him, "Go wash yourself in the pool of Siloam." Siloam means sent. So the man went and washed and came back seeing. And his neighbors and others who knew him as a blind beggar asked each other, "Isn't this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said he was, and others said, "No, he just looks like him." The beggar kept saying, "I am the same one." And Jesus asked, "Who healed you? What happened?" He told them, "The man they called Jesus made mud and spread it over my eyes and told me, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash yourself.' So I went and washed, and now I can see." "Where is he now?" they asked. "I don't know," he replied. And then I also want to do one verse from 38. "Yes, Lord, I believe," the man said, and he worshiped Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. We're thankful that we've heard it. We're thankful that we can be together, even in this way, people watching online and not being able to do some of the things we're used to doing. And Father, there's a lot of fear about what goes on in this world today. There's a lot of discomfort and stress. There's a lot of anxiety. And Father, give us the strength to bear the burden of what we're going through, to remember that no matter what, your grace is sufficient, that your love is always present, and that we as your people, we can get through this. We can do it together. We can do it because of the faith we put in you, the trust that we put in you, the love that we can put in you, the obedience that we can put in you, and the holiness that you are, and how you instill that in our lives. Father, we thank you. We praise you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. It's kind of an interesting story. This guy who is blind gets this question about how it is that he was born this way. What was it that was wrong with him and what he did? Did he sin? How did this occur? And this is a common question that a lot of people get inside of ancient culture. They see the verses of God hands down punishment over generations and things go on. And so they assume that when they see this guy and he's born this way and everybody knows it, so he's not an uncommon person. And when they see this, they think, okay, he has got to have done something wrong. So surely this is the way this is. And a lot of this also comes from wisdom literature that was written in Israelite culture, where they talked about it from Job and the conversation that Job has with his friends who are accusing him. The reason why Job has lost his family, he's lost his all of his belongings and everything's wrong with him is because he's done something wrong. And Job continually defends himself. I haven't done anything. I haven't done anything. And in the end, it's true. He hasn't done anything. He has done nothing wrong. And because he's not done anything wrong, and even though that kind of fits into their mindset, here we fast forward all the way to Jesus, and Jesus is walking along, and everybody wants to know. He had to have done something wrong. Surely something wasn't right. Because here he is, and so it's either him or his parents. Which is it? And the answer is neither. The answer is for the glory of God. Now, this is something that we sometimes see too. There are people that we come across in our own lives who believe that because of any number of things that they've done, and it's a paranoia, it's something that fits inside their brain. I remember clearly after 9/11 that there were preachers and people who stood up in front of audiences and proclaimed the reason why the attack had come was because America was unfaithful. And I remember, and those kinds of things come into play inside of moments like this. Here I am standing in an empty room and preaching a sermon, and we're recording it, and you're watching it, and people say, well, the reason why this is occurring inside of our world is because people have sinned. Jesus answers his own disciples when they ask that question, who sinned, the parents or the person? Jesus says, actually, neither one. This is for God's glory. So the first point is who sinned? Well, no one in this case. No one. No one has gone through this. And where there are times in which God used the sinfulness of people to do certain things, In the days of the kings, this happened all the time. In the days of the prophets, this happened all the time. Does this happen today? Yes, it happens. But in this particular case, in this moment, Jesus says neither one. Neither one. I guess the first thing I would say to somebody when they asked me, he said, can you pass a judgment on the times and the situation and the culture that we're in and the things that are going on? What's really happening here? I would say, don't be so quick to judge. Don't be so quick to label something that you believe is wrong or you believe is happening or you are prophetically saying this is what's going on when you don't really know. Hesitate for a moment. Hesitate for a moment, because the truth is, on the other side of this man's blindness, on the other side of this man living as long as he had with this blindness that he had from the birth, from his entire life, on the other side of this was God's glory. On the other side of the pain and the suffering, on the other side of the doubt, on the other side of the confusion, on the other side of the paranoia, on the other side of the fear, on the other side of what we believe and what we think is really going on, there could just be God's glory being shared and going through it just brings us to that point. This is why people who believe that when you become a Christian, when you become a disciple of Jesus, this is why they believe. They come across and they say, okay, here's what's going to happen. You're going to get saved and then nothing bad is ever going to happen to you. Nothing bad is ever going to happen. Well, that's not true. That can't be true. That can't be right. Because there's still suffering in the world. There's still suffering in the lives of people. You have access this morning to our prayer list, and on that prayer list, you're going to see a numerous amount of people who are still dealing with things in their life, in their bodies, where they're sick or where they're hurting or where they're tired, where something's not right, and that suffering is there. And for us to just come out and say, well, you can't suffer. You must be doing something wrong. If you're suffering, you must have sin in your life. How incredibly insensitive would someone be? Jesus just says it's for God's glory. So perhaps the reason that we need to hold back, perhaps the reason we need to see this a little differently is the same reason that Jesus' disciples needed to see it a little differently as well. This happened that the power of God could be seen in him. And then he goes off on this whole thing where he says we must quickly carry out the tasks assigned to the one assigned to us. These tasks that are being given to us. Why? Because you never know. God's glory tends to show up in the way that God's glory tends to show up. And if you blink your eye and you're too busy and you got too much going on in your head that's full of fear or full of stress or full of anxiety or full of things, that you might just miss it. Don't miss it. Keep your eyes on what is true. Keep your eyes on what is right. Keep your eyes on Jesus, and then you don't have to worry about some of these kinds of things. I really don't. I place no value in these sorts of prophetic doom and gloom sort of mentalities, nor do I place any trust in the person who comes along and says, well, you're saved and you're never going to have any problems. There's really not a whole lot of trust that's to be found in any of those kinds of things, because really what's in front of us is the task that we have been given to carry on the work of God, to carry on who he is in our lives and how he lives in us to someone else. That's our task. That's our goal. These guys are walking along and they kind of get sidetracked as to what's really going on here. And Jesus is reminding them, hey, you know what, guys? You're supposed to be following me. You're supposed to be learning what you're supposed to be doing. And how you're supposed to do it. And then he clarifies it. There's darkness in the world. There's ugliness in the world, but I'm the light. I'm the light. Yes, there's blindness in this guy. Yes, there is sickness in the world. Yes, there is hurting. Yes, there are people who are asking questions. Yes, there's difficulty going on, and we are feeling the effects of that. But we aren't bound by four walls. We're bound by the light of the world. And the light of the world took spit and put it on the ground. Now, this is where it gets really weird. I mean, why does he use spit? Of all the things to use, why does he choose to use spit? The light of the world, the one who you're supposed to have your focus on, the one who you're supposed to maintain your trust in, and everything about Jesus is who he is, and yet he takes spit. The other day, we were talking to a bunch of teenagers, and I was asking them, what is your favorite miracle? And everybody was going through all their favorite miracles. And one of our teenagers mentioned this story. I was thrilled when it came up. But all of the stories of Jesus walking on the water and raising the dead and all of these kinds of things, they all kind of came up. And this one kind of, you're kind of like, really? I mean, Jesus is walking along and there's a guy who says, you know, come and heal my servant. And Jesus doesn't even have to go in the house. He just says, hey, your faith, and go along, buddy, your servant's okay. And that's what happens. Jesus doesn't enter the house, he doesn't touch the servant, I mean, nothing goes on, and there it is, there's healing. Jesus doesn't have to do this, so why does he do it? Why does he do this? I love it when he does. I love the creativity of it. I love the passionate way in which he grabs hold of this guy and he takes spit and he puts it, he wants him to see. See, the problem with us is that we think the deformity of sin cannot be cast aside by the glory of the light of the world. And that's not true. So the dirt that we are, the ground that we come from, made into mud, put on the guy's eyes, and he's clean, washed in water. And it's a little bit ironic that of all the places Jesus sends him to, well, it's not ironic, it's just the way he does it. He says he sent him to the pool where it's called scent. He sends him to scent. He's making an impression, not just on the man, but on the people that are around him. Trust in it. Bank on it. Know that I've got the power to do this. Know that the glory of God is being shown forth. Know that I'm going to cover your sins. The cover of the deformity of sin not of the blindness, but the deformity of sin is what's really at stake here. Why does he do it? Because he wants to show us what he can do and what he is doing with our sin. And so he sends him to be washed clean. That's why he uses spit. Is it odd? Yes, it is incredibly odd. I remember teaching this one time, and a lady said to me, I just don't think this can be right. I don't think it can be right because Jesus is disgusting. And here we are in this place, and we're talking, and we're dealing with social distance and all of the things of germs and saliva and all of these kinds of issues. And yet here's this story of Jesus, and he just spits on, you know, takes some mud with some spit, and he puts it on the guy's eyes. And yes, it is disgusting. Yes. But it has a purpose. And the purpose is to move beyond what we think is the dirty, move beyond what we think is the shame, move beyond what we think is the thing that's holding us back and into the wondrous glory of who God is. And it really doesn't matter how you play that out. It's really, really effective when you just think of it not just as sin, but everything, the doubt, the confusion, the hopelessness, the fear, whatever it is that plagues inside of who we are as people, that Jesus has the ability to cover himself on those things and bring glory in that moment to who he is so that healing occurs. That's what's going on here. Is that Jesus is preparing this man and sending him to be healed, but he's also saying to the people around the man and to us, hey, I've got what's wrong with you. I'm going to bring light into this world. I'm going to raise the dead of sin. I'm going to bring hope to the hopeless. I'm going to bring healing to the hurting. I'm going to bring something to all of these people. So what really occurs in here is that who you are as a human being, who you have become in your sin, gets eradicated by who he is as God over our lives. And so then everybody starts asking. And this is where I only read 12 verses of this entire thing. And while you're home today, you should really go ahead and read this entire chapter. Because what happens here is Jesus does a very odd thing. He heals the man in an odd way. And if you're looking at, if you read the entirety of the Gospel of John, it's not, I guess, that surprising that he would do something like this. But people around the place, they begin to say, what's really going on here? And you'll notice at this point, when you get into the story that Jesus doesn't know the guy, and the guy doesn't know Jesus, and when he goes and he can see, he still hasn't met him. There's nothing here where Jesus goes along with them. As a matter of fact, what happens is the man leaves. Jesus doesn't know the man. He's never seen him before, or he's never interacted with him before. He goes along, and he's there they have the healing, and then Jesus sort of disappears from the story. And so now, when you get to the part of the story that I didn't read, and if you want to follow along, you just have to read this at home. When you follow along from verse 13 all the way to the one I did read in 38, everybody wants to know what's really going on here. Everybody wants to know. Now, Jesus is not in the story anymore. He's not there. And here they all talk, and all the things that they can talk about are Jesus healed somebody on the Sabbath. Jesus healed someone on the Sabbath. And they say, this man is not from God. He's working on the Sabbath. And other people are arguing. They're saying, hey, you know, how could he not be from God when he's doing these miraculous signs? It's clear, by the way, that's another part of the mud. That's the fun part of the mud and the saliva on the ground and putting it on the guy's eyes. It's clear something's going on here. I mean, can you imagine this guy walking around? You're going through Walmart, you see a guy, and all of a sudden you walk around, you see a guy, and he's got mud all over his eyes. You go, hey, man, you kind of got some mud on your face there, buddy. What's going on? Well, that's what happens here. Now the man who they all did know is a blind beggar, there we go, he can see. So they're asking the question, who is this person? And they want to know who healed him. They want to know how it worked out. And the man says, well, I guess he must be a prophet. He has to be a prophet. Well, he's got to be something special. And then they call in the guy's parents. Well, wait a second. We started the story with the parents, so you knew they were going to come into play here. So they call the parents in, and they want to know, well, hey, where did this happen? I mean, is this got to be fake? This has got to be fake. Well, it's not fake. He was blind. We can see. We don't have anything to do with this. They back away from it. He's old enough, they say. Ask him. So they call him in again. And they say, you know, you got to give glory to God, but don't give any to Jesus because he's a sinner, because he healed on the Sabbath. And they say, hey, the guy says, I don't know. I don't know anything about this. All I know is I was blind. Now I see. Then finally you get the interaction. You finally get the interaction with Jesus and this man. The guy couldn't see Jesus at first. They didn't even talk. Jesus just goes over to the guy and takes some spit, puts it on the ground, makes some mud, puts it on the guy's eyes. There's no conversation except for Jesus to go tell him to wash in the pool. Nothing going on. Now they're finally going to talk. So Jesus, he can now see Jesus. Jesus can now see him. Now they're going to have a conversation. Verse 35, he says, do you believe in the Son of Man? He says, who is he? I want to believe, but I need to be able to see him. And Jesus says, you have seen him. It's he who's speaking to you. And that's when the man says, yes, Lord, I believe. And Jesus says something that's really important that we need to hear. He says, I entered this world to render judgment, to give sight to the blind and show those who think they see that they are blind. One of the harder passages of the entire time that Jesus is talking, he is talking to a group of people who believe that they are the only ones who've got this figured out. They're the only ones who've got it going on. They're the only ones who are the religious people and all of these sorts of things. And this is the thing that really drives this home. He's looking at them and saying, hey, listen, if you're going to follow me, and this is what we learn from a passage like this. If you're going to follow me, I'm the light of the world. Church, we cannot trust in four walls. We cannot trust in government. We cannot be saved by any of those things. A virus will come and a virus will go. Good times will come and bad times will come. And our trust can't be placed in those good times. And we can't lose all hope in bad times. The truth is, we trust only in Jesus because he's the light of the world. And because he's the light of the world, then we find ourselves in a place where we have to be covered by him. We have to be covered by him. We have to allow him to place himself into who we are as people, and he has to cover us with who he is. In this case, the man's blindness. But once we can see, once he takes off who we were and now who he wants us to be, once we're in this place and we're supposed to be giving glory and we're supposed to be worshiping and we're supposed to be living and we're supposed to be full of hope, we're supposed to have all of this trust, then it's important for us to recognize that we place ourselves into the framework of all that Jesus is and then trust him to be God in our lives and then don't doubt it. Now that's hard to do. It's easy to say. It's hard to do. Jesus looks at these people and says, here's the thing. I came to render judgment. I came to tell you that this is the way this is going to go. I'm going to give sight to the blind and show that those who think they see, they are actually blind. Now, he didn't say he came to render those people who are actually blind into nothingness. He wants them to see too. But because they didn't admit that they were actually wrong, the man finally gets it. The disciples finally get it, and it's time for us to get it too. Jesus says, if you're blind, you wouldn't be guilty, but you remain guilty because you claim you can see. It's time for us to see. Only in Jesus does our trust lie. Only in him do we find ourselves in a place where we can follow him 100%, and it won't matter the things that are going on outside of our walls and who we are as people shouldn't be moved on because of times or things that are going on, but only because of who Jesus is. And announce his presence and who we are as people. And as you go out, inevitably people are going to go outside. Inevitably there's going to be more cases that come along. Inevitably but one of these days we're going to hear it and someone's going to say, hey, it's finally abating. You can go back to normal. You can go into worship. You can go into work. You can do all of these things. And when that occurs, in that moment, will we see really, truly what God has done? For in our hope and in the presence of who he is, we remain and always will remain his people. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We're thankful for your truth and who we are as people. We're thankful that we have heard from your word. And now, Father, even though in this place, in this moment, where most everybody is going to have to watch this on a small phone or on a tablet or even on a screen just with themselves, with their own family members. It feels like we're not really doing what we're supposed to be doing. It feels like this is just too different, too odd, and too much. But the truth is that you just want to cover us in your love and in your grace. Father, thank you for revealing in us who you are. Father, thank you for the glory that you've given us in the healing of our blindness. Thank you for giving us the truth that in the grace that we carry, you've removed our blindness and that we are made whole. And Father, even in these times, it's really up to us to share with the world that you and you alone are worthy of our trust and declare the truth that you are God over our lives, that your Son came to die and lives with us and in the power of your Spirit. Father, we thank you, we praise you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. So we'll wrap up our service. We hope you have a good week. We'll see you again right here next week. Have a great week.